used by the BAM Center, for example, James Prophet's Project Cells, which was a very exciting early scientific visualization collaboration with a geneticist and a cancer researcher, mathematician, and of course, Jane played the role of both artist and designer. Interactive screen was a very important part of the BAM Center. It was an opportunity to kind of bring together artists and designers and companies that were emerging in the interactive and digital media space and try and use creativity to influence the kinds of products and projects that would come to play with their world. There was a sort of notion, of course, I'm just going to show these slides, but we also were very active at the Banff Media Institute, engaging television directors, producers, and broadcasters, creating awareness about the digital revolution, and supporting independent television through workshops, work studies, and productions. But one of the remarkable qualities of that interaction was the kind of denial in many ways within the broadcast industry and distribution industry of the kind of disintermediation that would occur through the impacts of interactive media, new media, digital media, and an entire shift in the marketplace. You may recognize some of these names. And then hand in hand with the work that we were doing through summits and work studies, was a very active co-production process, which allowed artists, designers, media researchers to access the technology that was very much part of the capacity of the BAM Center, especially after 2000, 2001. Just some slides for co-productions. Tapio Michaela and David Rokeby's remarkable saunas, network saunas, where you could sit in a sauna in Helsinki and a sauna at the BAM Center and communicate with others in that sauna, seeing their bodies through a kind of blur that David kindly placed so you couldn't have explicit details, but hearing them perfectly, and then diving into the pool at the BAM Center and the sounds of people swimming would reverberate through the saunas in both Helsinki and Banff. So those were the kinds of co-productions that we were undertaking at Banff. Very important component of the Banff Center, which I'll talk about in a moment, was its passionate commitment to Aboriginal arts and providing a platform for a lot of the very early work that was done by Indigenous artists and producers and technology researchers in the space of new media. So Speaking the Language of Spiders was a very important project that was begun by Ahasu Isku, who began a project with Indigenous people who had spent time on the streets, and it was a cyclical story that told about seven generations and how they would bring a future to Indigenous experience in amazingly interactive new media work. Lawrence Paul Kalupton, Inherent Rights, Vision White Rights, one of the first artistic virtual reality projects ever produced and created by the BAM Center in collaboration with BioApparatus, beginning in 1989, completed in 1993, using a very kind of simple IBM platform, but experiencing and exploring the capacity of Indigenous concepts of graphics and the longhouse and appropriate access to the gods and the creatures within the cosmology of Indigenous knowledge. So, of course, the Banff Media Institute had a very strong commitment to research and created a series of technical facilities which were known as the Advanced Research Technologies, or ART labs, that were sustained ongoing research at the Banff Media Institute through the hosting of artists and researchers' residencies. So there was a CAVE with related visualization and virtual reality software, a collaboration territory with all manner of networked capacity and the ability to work with researchers and artists in many different locations, kind of experimental space to look at shoot performances and other ways to think about collaboration. And then quite a sophisticated mobile engineering and physical computing lab that had a focus on wearable technologies. And I think part of what was so important about the kind of research that artists undertook was the ability to raise important ethical concerns and critique technology as well as use technology to insist on a kind of really diverse or relativist approach to the use and even the design of technology. And to do this in the face of engineering, cognitive science, and artificial intelligence, which drive still to this day, drive towards universality. So the kind of pragmatic role of artists in pursuing new applications that are inclusive has been, I think, a very significant importance. And the Banff Center, to its credit, was a kind of leader in that space. So did the lab succeed at Banff? And I think this is one of those questions that always has to be asked. I mean, Banff was an independent center. It wasn't a university. And it was very successful when there were significant partners and projects. So Interval Research in California, Paul Allen's shop, which provided tremendous support for the Art and Virtual Environments project, funding for that project from Heritage Canada, software from Softimage, and Alias Wavefront that enabled that research to happen. When there were visiting researchers, so Dr. Maria Lanton, who ran the art labs, was particularly talented at bringing in researchers who could undertake projects for shorter periods of time to build a prototype and visualization in VR, in audio, with a very focused and disciplined approach to using the labs. When there was funding to refresh the technology, where of course there was a dependency on research councils or provincial funding authorities, and when there was funding to support in-house research. So that was true for a number of us who were located at the Banff Center and able to bring in consistent research grants. But I think one of the challenges in building a lab environment at a place like Banff is that when the funding didn't exist and when there wasn't a way of consistently supporting research, which tended to need significant both capital and operating support, then the labs would lie fallow, and they lie fallow to this day. So some lessons there. This is opening of the grand labs. This is the visualization cave. Sort of fun to see people with goggles on in 2003, when, of course, we're in the era of both Facebook and Google's move into various kinds of goggle technology. So an unencumbered environment, and these are just some images from the Art and Virtual Environment program, which was a groundbreaking program in bringing artists and computer scientists together to create various kinds of experimental virtual reality worlds. And a very important moment in Canada's history when Heritage Canada stepped in to create the New Media Research Networks, which explicitly stood in for the failure of National Centers of Excellence program to support creative research. There were two attempts to build an NCE. Eventually, in 2008, the Grand National Center of Excellence was funded. But before that time, it was a kind of desert of funding for significant research in art and technology or sci art. And then, of course, Canary, for a period of time, funded creative research if there was a technology component to it. So just some examples of projects that were a result of having two or three years of extensive support, significant support from federal program, the Heritage Program, and industry partners, including Nokia and Hewlett-Packard Labs, Mobile Digital Commons Network, exploring the nature of mobile experiences that were driven by sensors, so outdoor experiences for the most part using GPS, GIS tracking and sensors. And remember, this is before smartphones, so feature phones. So a lot of fun exploring and a lot of really amazing capacity in terms of narrative and experience design. A lot of work with body storming methods, to imagine navigation, using mobile phone experiences, and of course working in the amazing environment of Banff. This is a project in the cemetery in Montreal, a story that was driven through little pieces of narrative as you went through the Banff Park and would be able to play games at various locations. And The Haunting, which was by the cemetery on Montreal's mountain. Technologies that spinned off from that experimental period of time, such as the Me Engine, which was an open source mobile experience design authoring system, and a number of ways of using intelligent systems and wearable technology, including very early work with soft circuits, sensors, embedded media, and even experiments with very early nanotech within that project. Am I Able, which was the second funded project, which had a large group of people working on it at SF Simon Fraser University, again Concordia and Banff, and was really exploring ways that wearable technologies would be able to help with communication, new forms of communication, with sports experiences, even health and wellness experiences. Remember, at one point, we were trying to develop a cessation smoking system using very fashionable watches, prodded you every time you wanted a cigarette or went for a cigarette with the University of Alberta, and beautiful work in performance and the use of wearable technology. So research that still has sort of valence to this day as we look at the incredible growth of wearable technologies. Banff was very involved with all kinds of international activities, both creating offsite events and collaborations, including a very significant workshop as part of the Dakar Biennale of Contemporary African Art that brought indigenous new media artists and curators and artists of African descent from Canada and embedded them within the Dakar Biennale of Contemporary Art to make new work, lead workshops, and create prototypes. And a pretty consistent relationship with galleries at the Banff Center to exhibit critically ideas about new media art. I mentioned the important engagement that Banff had with Aboriginal arts at the Banff Center and its drive to support Indigenous efforts in new media and emerging media, and also a very kind of passionate relationship with cultural diversity and with gender equity within these emerging fields, where often there were very few women in the room as technologies were being designed and invented, bringing colleagues from Africa and many other places. So I'm going to finish very briefly in terms of the Banff New Media Institute and what it represents, and then move on. But we put together a phenomenal archive at the Banff Center that was online until recently, and it was taken down about a year and a half ago. And we have been encouraging the Banff Center to reinstate that archive. It's a phenomenal resource for both this generation and future researchers. So it has audio recordings, commissioned reports, great documentation of the Banff New Media Institute's activities. And of course, from the book that Sarah Cook and I created, which is still available and available online. But what I wanted to do very briefly was just talk about the themes in that book, which really were an opportunity for us to look retrospectively at, 10 years of activity, really 15 years of activity by the Banff New Media Institute and the kind of preoccupations there. And I think you'll see resonance with what is happening now at OCAD University in our research lab. So a very deep interest in data. We talked about data as being material, investigating it through its materiality, the changes in the nature of data, its organization, its expression through memory, understandings of artificial intelligence, and the kind of impact of data in the material world. I think we were ahead of our time in understanding that. So looking at both visualization and simulation, data as a material that had its beauty, Using data across both scientific visualization and information visualization through a whole series of summits and then collaborative research networks that emerged through this process. Physics perception and immersion was another very important theme in the years of the Daphne Media Institute. So this idea of imaging technologies, the transformation of how we understand visuality and spatial relationships, the idea of four and n dimensions, and the kind of physical and virtual architectures and the emerging nature of immersive technologies, completely relevant again as we move into an era of augmented and virtual reality. And I've been one of the people pushing very hard for us not to lose that early history of theoretical work and critical thinking. Becoming machine and staying human. So how we define the nature of human and human, the mechanic, the mécanique, as in constant transformation. So my kind of biopolitics of Foucault and understanding the changing nature of the lens and perception, and of course of the environment and its sustainability through a whole series of engagement with the space in between the human and the artificial and the natural. And then a kind of focus on social and individual identities. So a profound interest in shifts in the ways that social and individual identity have been expressed in new media. So the kind of alternate cultures in the World Wide Web through streamed audio and video, gaming and producing new structures of knowledge as well as play, and a tremendous interest in emerging social media and of ways that identities were being critiqued and constructed within the internet as a space of culture, money and law. So ways of thinking about new models of money, economic viability and law from licensing to appropriation to open source, and really playing an activist role in trying to create a new media industry that was sophisticated and engaged in the kinds of work that artists could do. And finally, production and distribution. So understanding new systems of distribution, of collaboration, and the ways that these were phenomenally enabled through kind of distribution of knowledge in the online environment. So I will at the end just talk a little bit about where there's convergence between these two worlds. And now I'm going to talk about Oakland University and some of the ways that I suppose as an institution we're approaching the process of discovery. But as many of you probably know, we're a big school, 4,700 students, about 300 graduate students, the majority undergraduate, and with a long history of art, design, media, culture, and social theory. Our largest programs are in graphic design, illustration, environmental design, industrial design, and drawing and painting. And this is relevant because I'm going to talk a bit about the way the labs are organized and you know, how they're sort of made meaningful through the work that happens in the academic program. So already, you know, a fundamental difference between a university and an independent research center is, you know, a university has faculty who are there for extended periods of time. You can build on research practice. You can collaborate within your institution. There's a kind of fundamental difference in the sort of stability of that kind of environment. This is a residency environment. And then, of course, there's students. And they're a creative labor force who want to engage with research in order to be able to, you know, move forward in their own knowledge formation. So I thought I would share this. This is our vision as an institution, incredibly important for how we see research as we're moving forward. So this idea about the imaginary and imagination being a multiplicity, that diversity is fundamental to defining imagination, that lived experience is fundamental, and that imagination is also something, you know, that's artificial, that's constructed through various kinds of agents and intelligences. So our vision is CAD University challenges you to audaciously and responsibly pursue the questions of our time through the powerful interplay of art, design, the social sciences, humanities, and the sciences. So this notion that we're no longer an art and design school, you know, we're an institution that engages with these other forms of knowledge, but through asking and answering challenging questions, through critique, through scientific, artistic discovery. And then this sort of set of calls to build aware, generous, and joyful communities, a kind of call for diversity, resilience, equity, inclusion, sustainability, respect for Indigenous sovereignty and cultures, so a kind of ethics statement, this belief in transformative that we have to be as an institution, but as faculty and students, transformative social, economic, environmental, and cultural agents, and that the tools for this transformation are materials, data, technology, and ideas enabled through or materialized through research, studio practice, learning, and embodied knowledge. So an interesting framing for an institution. And just historically, it's probably important to say that, you know, OCA, Ontario College of Art in the 80s, and then OCAD, Art Design, were really was home to electronic arts in the 80s, you know, robotics by artists, attractive media, computer music, Mike Snow, Norman White, David McIntosh, Judith Joyle, Simone Jones. I mean, it's a very significant list of names of former faculty and current and alumni. And this sort of maker culture is still part of the DNA and very much realized through artistic practice in the labs and through curriculum. We also have a very passionate commitment to Indigenous knowledge and a visual culture tier one, the research chair, less involved technologies other than digital humanities, the methodology. And then a growing interest in life studies and visual arts, so biology, science, ecology, and the body. And program associated with that for many years is our integrated media program, which has opened new fields of digital painting and expanded animation, and very much sort of looking at from an art practice, the invention of new technologies. And then when design became part of the school in a more formal way, design was present really from the early 20th century, but it was acknowledged late in the 20th century, the development of true design thinking methods. Let's look at design thinking and making, problem-based and user-focused, the design of technologies using human perspectives, including a kind of twisting and tweaking of existing technologies. So strong remake culture, reuse culture, with a deep commitment to zero carbon design and sustainability, and very recently, capacity in design for health research, biomimicry, kind of post-digital design. And our new dean of design has termed as a design ethnographer of generous design. Just some sense of, you know, again, this sort of international capacity for research and engagement. And then a view of innovation and research, which is really, you know, seeing art and design as central and driving components in their own right of research, but also of all forms of innovation, you know, of health, medicine, material science, biology, the digital economy, engineering, and social science. So you saw that in the vision statement. And, you know, we've been very activist as Canada's federal government reframes its inclusive innovation strategy to really talk about the role of art and design. So the Digital Media Research and Innovation Institute was founded in 2008. Again, as I mentioned, uniquely in a university context. But it has real similarities, I think, to Hexagram, to LSAT, to a lot of the activity that's happening, you know, internationally still within the space. Very important to say that only a component of research at OCADU is focused on digital technology. And again, it's characterized by using opportunities to fund experimental research and very applied industry-focused research. And you'll see this kind of alignment of academic programs at the lab. So a kind of different methodology to how the Banff New Media Institute works. So this is the constellation of labs, at least sort of in the initial stage, they've emerged and changed. And there's some new labs that have developed. But the big themes that I'm seeing that have some congruity with the Banff Media Institute, but also other kinds of shifts, are a much less utopian view of social media and social sharing in the era of hypermedia, surveillance, post-digital aesthetics, you know, glitch culture, and the kind of crisis of, you know, the claustrophobic space of social media. Again, real continuity with immersion, vision research, the full sensorium, perception and cognition, more and more engagement with biotechnology, biomedical technology, biopolitics and bioethics, tremendous focus on urban sustainability, on livability and wellness, and focus not only on visualization, but data materiality, and very much data is IoT, wearable technology, and embodied technologies. And this is just a list of the labs. I'm not going to run through all of them, but I'm going to talk about some of them and this sort of relationship between, you know, our curriculum. So the digital teaching program, which is very much about disruptive technologies and thought leadership to both form people who will work in industry, but also will be researchers and artists and interveners, you know, with a academic program that looks at innovation, science, computer science, engineering, and design and art, and both highly collaborative and sort of individual approaches to making, and with a focus on partnered research and innovation that in many ways kind of comes out of that capacity within the digital media curricular offerings. So these are, I just kind of threw up some of the industry partners that we work with and sort of the funding sources. And I will talk about that at the end, but we also have very strong focus on inclusive design. This is one of our, this is our largest, most capable research center that really looks at inclusion for people with disabilities, inclusion for people with constrained literacies, numeracy, much looking at social and equity issues in terms of social inclusion. And these folks are a combination of health researchers, engineers, computer scientists, and designers. And aligned with it is an inclusive design graduate program, which again, look very much at these questions of both social and technological inclusion. Our mobile experience lab, which works a lot with the digital futures graduate programs again, and kind of looking at location, context for applications. So real continuity here from the sort of work that was happening in engineering, mobile experiences, and some of the most interesting research is, you know, in the space of mindfulness technologies, so brainwave monitoring applied to areas such as fetal alcohol visualization and working with kids who are survivors of fetal alcohol syndrome. Social Body Lab, which is looking at the expressive and perceptive nature of the human body, so body-based systems related to mobile and wearable technologies and the Internet of some great examples of research there. And then again, a strong interface with our industrial design program and with our digital futures program, the Strategic Innovation Lab, which is really where we differentiate in the space of design thinking. This is a lab that looks at possible futures, the intersection of human behavior, new technologies, and organizational capacity, and makes use of data to do that work, as well as a whole series of design and kind of future visioning and play tools. Yes. Yes. Oh, okay. I had myself 5 more minutes. I'm sorry. Is that okay? Yeah. Okay. So I'll keep going. And then our Strategic Foresight Lab, you know, working again very closely with a program, a graduate program. So, and other areas of interest are gaming, not just through this. Data visualization is one of our areas of deep expertise, sort of looking at data analytics and materialization with partnerships with data holders in areas that are relevant, I think, to, again, some of the themes that I expressed around the future of cities, cultural analytics, health, sonification, data, and materialization, and addressing challenges in big data. So the lack of criticality regarding the nature of data sets and their origins, the problem that scientific realism dominates science and engineering, and the kind of expectations of how visualization work, the need to produce new aesthetic theories, issues of ethics and access and open data and empowerment through visualization, and then with that, numeracy. And then on a more practical level, pragmatic level, design, interaction, you know, the nature of the interface, tangibility, materiality of data. And highly dependent on our graphic design curriculum and students, which are teaching data, learning data analytics and visualization, environmental design in terms of urban analytics, which has moved more and more into, you know, working with data. And again, just some examples of projects. I'll move the slides quickly. Some very interesting work in using MRI and various kinds of scan technology to help in healthcare research and to materialize that which is built in virtual space. I'll just quickly go through these slides. And then we've really moved into the space of health research. So that interest in, you know, biomedical research with a new program in Design for Health that's very much aligned with both the institutional healthcare research environment and working in everything from looking at the future of brain health and aging and how to support those processes to interactive experiences using sensor systems and visualization and music to support older people, and but with a much more set of traditional outputs than the Banff Media Institute. So publication, presentation, increasing work in policy-focused research and innovation, and then finally, an incubation environment much more amplified than the Banff Center was ever capable of, which launches companies and products that are design focused and basically emerge from our research labs or other university research labs in Ontario that are partnered with our recent graduates and our faculty. So again, you know, and I'm ending here. So, you know, the structure and support for labs, again, depends a lot on active researchers who are able to find funding, whether it's through the Canada Council, the Canadian Tri-Council system, Ontario's research funding mechanisms, framework research. So there's always a criteria challenge that I would say is maybe a growing criteria challenge as Canada locks down to more of a sort of STEM-focused environment in its Tri-Council research. And I would say a lot more dependency on commercial, institutional, and not-for-profit partnerships and research in order to keep that environment alive. And then interesting thinking and work right now on the idea of individual versus collective leadership of the lab infrastructure, where it's been very much individual researchers leading the labs, moving now towards a collective infrastructure. And of course, a kind of an event context very similar to Banff. So that's my presentation.
And this is a wonderful way to kick it off. Thank you, Sarah. Thank you. Let's see if we have questions from people in the attendance. Is there any questions?
I would just say that I think our role is very much, you know, historically and now, for those of us leading these kinds of environments, is to really help to promote, you know, new methodologies, even when we're working in an industrial setting, to try and, you know, in collaborative research, to really try and ask questions that would not be asked if an artist or designer was not at the table.
Mm-hmm. Yes. So, just a second. Luc Corchin has a question.
Hello, Sarah in Sao Paulo, Luc in Montreal. How do you see all this art as research with technology filtering out in society? We've been in that bubble for 20, 30, 40 years sometimes now, in these beautiful labs with this privileged group of people having access to funds and equipment and things like that. And now, you know, we're teaching it in the universities, like you do at OCAD. But how do you see that we're impacting on people's life through, you know, something outside of our zone of comfort, and even outside of academia, because you're still in academia. Do you see us making progress in the art market, for example? Do you see us, or what we do, impacting on, you know, clothing design, on architecture, on things that people do without any knowledge of all that research behind.
So it's hard to hear because it's an echo, but I think you asked me about, you know, how are we making progress with basically moving the kind of research that's happening outside of the laboratory environment and through our partners. One of the things that we're pretty proud of at the school is that, for example, the visual analytics lab, all of the research is partnered. So we only work with actual data sets. So we make sure that whatever we do, and there's a big focus on user engagement and user engagement from the beginning and in kind of constant sort of virtual circle of checking in with people both who provide data sets and who are users of the potential outcomes in technology. So we've seen a lot of adoption of the inventions or solutions coming out of our labs by some of our partners. That's true with that lab, the Inclusive Design Research Center. Their methodology is much more of an open source methodology. So they've got real muscle power around being able to support an open source environment. So they've actually seen some of the things, really important things that they've developed, be adopted even by like Apple, IBM, et cetera, as infrastructure that allows, you know, SMEs to lock in and invent technologies coming off of that backbone that they've created, or users to actually have direct access to the tools that they've created who are disabled and in wheelchairs or, hearing or sight impaired. But, you know, in the visual analytics lab, we don't have that capacity to support an open source environment. We don't have that kind of muscle power. So what we try and do instead is work with partners who are able to take what we develop and actually really use it themselves. They have the ability to take the prototype and adapt it into their environment. I hope that helped to answer. And it's not just publication, it's also exhibition and, you know, discourse.
Thank you, Sarah. We have another question.
Montreal now is in the big trend, supposed to become the capital of AI with true machine learning, and you've been a visionary since so many years. So what do you think about the possibility of developing an aesthetic of machine learning?
You know what? It was very hard for me to hear that. There's an echo with the mic, so could somebody just repeat it, maybe closer?
Okay. In Montreal, Montreal is supposed to be the next capital of artificial intelligence.
Yeah.
And we have a big trend around the machine learning. Machine learning.
Yeah.
Okay. And I would like to know, as a visionary person, What do you think about the emergence of the aesthetic of machine learning?
Okay, so that's a great question. We're just looking at another lab that we're hoping to build, which is called the Big Data Design Lab, and it works with technology researchers and developers of machine learning and artificial intelligence. Which, I mean, we're already working in that space in both the Social Body Lab. There's another lab I didn't talk about that does a lot of work with gaming and wearable technologies and inclusive design, visual analytics lab. So it's, you know, AI has been at the core of data analytics from the beginning. It's not new. It gets renamed. It's kind of gotten naturalized. So we're working on a lab that would very explicitly place the question of where human intelligence, human agency, human creativity, human labor should be in relationship to machine learning. So, because we think researchers at OKU see this as a really fundamental both ethical and design challenge. So we kind of pushed ourselves to the IBMs of the world, Esri, others, to say, put us at that interface. Let us ask those critical questions. Let's not make assumptions that everything should be, automated. And let's look at places that, shouldn't be, can't be, where there needs to be checks and balances. And I think the other piece that maybe I skipped over is, we're constantly saying data is not neutral. Data is mediation. Data is produced. You need a kind of critical engagement with understanding the nature of data and each data set. So those two things together, I think, are very important. But I don't think we can step away from that space. And I think it's really important to engage and also look at questions of privacy and, the sort of invasive nature of biomedical data, for example. I'm probably not even answering what you asked me. Sorry.
So we have to leave you now, Sarah.
Okay.
I would like to thank you for your involvement in the new media art field on the Canadian base and international base. So. Elle est déjà partie. Alors, il y a une pause de 15 minutes. On revient vers 10h30 pour le prochain panel. Merci.
Aria Dean is an artist, writer, and curator based in Los Angeles. She's assistant curator of net art at Rhizome. Her writing has been featured in Art Forum, The New Inquiry, Real Life Magazine, Topical Cream Magazine, and Extra Contemporary Art Quarterly. She also co-directs the gallery and project space As It Stands, LA. Aria Dean.
Hi. Hello, can you hear me? Okay. Hi, I'm Aria, and thank you for having me today. I'm the assistant curator of net art and digital culture at Rhizome, which is a digital or born digital institution based in New York, and we're loosely affiliated with the New Museum. Our focus is on digital art and culture. We were founded 20 years ago in 1996 by Mark Tribe, an artist. We were founded as a community-based organization. A community-based organization, and we still function as such, as a hub for artists and those interested in net art. Our website houses a rich and maze-like history of the world of net art. Our program these days consists mostly of publishing writing online, holding public programs, supporting artist projects, and staging online exhibitions. Our most recent and ambitious undertaking is a project called Net Art Anthology. This is the microsite for it. You can find it at anthology.rhizome.org. We launched this project this October. Net Art Anthology is a 2-year online exhibition that endeavors to retell the story of net art, of net art history. And so at Rhizome, we define net art as art that acts on the network or is acted upon by the network. So it's sort of a expanded definition of net art rather than just browser-based artworks. It includes networked performances, objects that appear in real space but are connected to objects online, and so forth. So this exhibition, over the course of the next 2 years, will restage and recontextualize one work per week on this microsite, which you can see here. We're also publishing essays, interviews, and holding in-person panel discussions alongside the re-performances of these works. So the anthology will unfold in 5 chapters, and we're currently in the first chapter. The first chapter is 1985 to 1998, which will represent the early web, and there are 20 works within each chapter of the exhibition. Then 1999 to 2005, which is the era of Flash and blogs. 2006 to 2011, the age of surf clubs, the birth of post-internet, and the rise of social media platforms. And 2012 through the present, well, which by that point will be 2018, since this goes for 2 years, which will represent mobile apps and social media saturation. And then the fifth chapter will be kind of going back to the beginning and filling in the gaps from 1985 to the present. And so the works that we're choosing, and there's 100 works in total, and we're choosing them on a rolling basis, so we're open to submissions and suggestions from artists and practitioners. Which is part of our community-oriented approach to exhibitions and publishing. But the works included must use the internet in ways that, and first, the first criteria is that they must use the internet in ways that give expression to emerging subjectivities. The second is that they model new forms of collective cultural practice. The third is that they exemplify aesthetic, subjective, political, and conceptual positions that have taken on singular importance or singular and profound resonance within particular networks of artists. And the final criteria is that they can be meaningfully restaged, reconstructed, or reperformed for this exhibition. So criteria number four is just what I'm going to talk about today. So the question sort of that plagues us throughout this process is, what does it mean to restage, reconstruct, or reperform a work of net art? And more broadly, how do we go about preserving net art or digital art? So the preservation of digital art is arguably more difficult than that of other mediums, like painting or sculpture. At the very least, it presents a different related set of problems. The very existence of the digital art object is quite precarious, and the data that comprises it is easily erasable and manipulable. Further, it is up for debate what the object is exactly. Is it the code? Is it the appearance of the work in the interface? Art conservation at large must ask similar questions. The goal of the field appears to be to maintain, at times even produce, the utmost authenticity of the art object. There are different positions on how to achieve this. Should you privilege the will of the artist? What if their wish is for the work to decay over time? Should the goal be to present the work in a form as close as possible to that of its original staging, in some version retaining its aura, to follow Walter Benjamin? It all feeds an underlying philosophical, ontological uncertainty about the boundaries of the art object. While these are certainly complex issues, they remain somewhat manageable when approaching a static object like a painting or a sculpture, in the sense, if only, that you're dealing with identifiably material properties of an object. On the other hand, digital art, whose existence pretty much relies wholly on the hardware and software capabilities of its time, and the media and platforms with life cycles of only a few years, it becomes quite a headache. So for example, there are countless flash animation-based works that are just not viewable in up-to-date browsers. One could attempt to reconstruct these works at the level of code, but that wouldn't be a long-term fix. Soon enough, the most up-to-date technology will become outdated. A good example of this sort of problem broadly is Shuli Cheng's Brandon, which is pictured here, the restoration of which the Guggenheim has undertaken in the last few years. Their method is seemingly something along these lines, updating it for a contemporary browser. But this is fairly labor-intensive and as well requires maintenance after the fact. Another example, how do we deal with interactivity that is central to so many net art works? We can't present something like Olya Lyalina's My Boyfriend Came Back from the War, which is pictured here in the NetArt Anthology interface. We can't present this work as a video, for instance, where we watch someone navigate through the work, because the central point of it is the interactivity, navigating through the multilinear hypertext narrative. That experience is central to the work, as is the user's voyeuristic engagement of the personal story. So presenting an even greater problem than My Boyfriend Came Back from the War or Brandon are the works that we engage with that engage the network in more outright performative and dispersed ways. One example is Electronic Disturbance Theater's 1997 work Floodnet. The work was a Java applet that would cause a web page to automatically reload itself over and over, crashing a given site if enough users attacked it. The applet was used to stage protests in solidarity with the Mexican Zapatista movement. But Rhizome, of course, in 2016 especially, can't stage a DDoS attack in order to represent an artwork, especially on like a government website, hoping that they'll recognize it as art. So for Floodnet, the boundaries of the art object are nearly impossible to determine and extremely difficult to represent. So the question becomes, what do we do? Our chosen method for attempting to preserve these works of net art is emulation. Basically, instead of conserving individual objects, we aim to conserve legacy environments in which these objects and practices initially appeared. Old browsers like Netscape, for instance. Our head of preservation has been leading a small team in creating a tool called Old Web Today, which is found at oldweb.today, and you can access that. And this is a lightweight in-browser emulation tool that mimics the interface and functionality of a given out-of-date web browser. So for NetArt Anthology, this means that we can reach back into the archive and present early NetArt works that as they appeared way back when. These are embedded on the NetArt Anthology site using containerized browsers. So here you can see it. This is Antoni Mundada's The File Room. And it's just embedded on the website in this containerized browser. And you can navigate this project was an archive of censorship that you can navigate. And we've reconstructed the majority of the archive. And it's fully functional. So there are a few reasons for choosing this approach. It reflects our belief that digital culture is a series of practices rather than artifacts. We believe digital art to be inherently performative. At Rhizome, our approach for preserving works like this hinges on the idea that digital culture is a series of practices and artifacts. Context is key. In some ways, it is a repurposing of some of Benjamin's ideas in the work of Art in the Age of Mechanical Reproduction. He wrote that the authenticity of the thing is the essence of all that is transmissible from its beginning, ranging from its substantive duration to its testimony to the history it has experienced. We are interested in some sense in relocating what for Benjamin amounted to the authenticity and cult value of a given object to a place outside of the object itself, the circumstances within which it was nested originally. For us, preserving the authenticity of digital art means preserving the conditions in which it was intended to be experienced. Again, one could attempt to mimic this, creating bespoke environments for every work of net art that one wishes to preserve. However, again, as noted, this would be extremely labor-intensive and thus limiting for the possibilities of preserving net art itself, basically just spending more time on fewer practices. Which brings me to a second reason for our use of emulation. We view the digital as a mass medium, as do many, if not most, of the artists we work with and whose work we want to preserve. Part of the excitement around net art has always been the widespread accessibility to its tools, or tools for creating, disseminating, and viewing it. Preserving the conditions of the artwork also preserves access to it, rather than recontextualizing it in an institutional collection divorced from the world from which it came. So in short, we believe that digital art should be accessible. So this approach is not perfect, and it does have its limits. Again, FloodNet is a good example. We can try to recreate an environment, but sometimes we cannot fully recreate the performance of the work itself, only simulate it. So for FloodNet, we have to create like a dummy server that gets attacked in order to use the applet, because we can't just stick it on a website. But in many other cases, we are working with works that have been almost entirely lost, or some that have also been censored. In these cases, this is where our community and artist-driven character comes in, and we work with artists to understand the nature of the work and the best way to adapt it to current conditions to the best of our ability. And finally, as I mentioned before, Old Web Today is available for public use at this website, oldweb.today. And you can use it yourself at any point to explore websites in legacy browsers, try to find your old blog if you want to. Thank you. That's it.
Geneviève Saulnier est restauratrice d'art contemporain au Musée des Beaux-Arts du Canada. Elle détient un bac de l'Université du Québec à Montréal et un certificat en chimie de l'Université Concordia. Elle a complété en 2003 une maîtrise en restauration de la peinture à Queens, après quoi elle développe son domaine d'expertise comme restauratrice d'art contemporain auprès de l'Institut canadien de conservation, du Musée des Beaux-Arts du Canada et du Centre de conservation du Québec. Elle s'est jointe au Musée des Beaux-Arts du Canada en 2004 et depuis, elle s'inscrit comme participante ou consultante à de nombreux organismes dont l'ADOCAM, le American Institute for Conservation, l'Association canadienne pour la conservation et la restauration et le Guggenheim Bilbao, ainsi que l'Université d'Ottawa. Geneviève Saulnier.
Merci. Bonjour à tous. Le sujet de ma présentation ne sera pas sur des cas, en fait, de migration, de restauration des œuvres d'art numériques au Musée des Beaux-Arts du Canada. J'ai décidé de vous parler aujourd'hui de l'histoire de l'acquisition et de la préservation, ainsi que les protocoles qui ont été établis au cours des ans. Et la raison pour laquelle j'ai décidé de vous parler de ça aujourd'hui, c'est que ça fait 10 ans, en fait, que les efforts de migration ont déjà commencé au musée. Et puis, c'est le temps, en fait, de réévaluer les plateformes de préservation pour les œuvres d'art. Alors, c'est un processus qu'on a débuté l'année passée. Et puis, c'est ça, je vais vous parler de ce qu'on est en train de faire. Alors, le Musée des Beaux-Arts du Canada collectionne les œuvres d'art de type numérique depuis la fin des années 60, mais c'est surtout dans les années 70, 80, 90 que la collection s'est bâtie. Les toutes premières catégories d'œuvres d'art médiatiques furent les films, et la plupart de ces films font partie de la collection du Musée des Beaux-Arts du Canada, mais il y en a un certain pourcentage qui fait partie de la collection de la bibliothèque, dont toute la collection Art Métropole qui a été déposée par A.A. Brunton, le membre du collectif General Idea. Pour le bien de cette présentation, j'ai décidé d'amalgamer les deux collections ensemble parce que je dois quand même m'en occuper de la collection de la bibliothèque. Le geste important historiquement par rapport au statut du film et de la vidéo qui avait été ici posé par le Musée des beaux-arts du Canada était d'avoir considéré ces films comme des œuvres d'art à part entière, au même niveau qu'une sculpture ou qu'une peinture, en fait. Le musée arrachait un peu ses œuvres au monde cinématographique pour leur donner un statut d'œuvre d'art. C'était des exemples, en fait, de films qui sont dans la collection du musée. Il n'y avait à cette époque aucune politique d'acquisition et de préservation spécialement conçue pour les œuvres d'art médiatiques. Les formats étaient acquis au travers de distributeurs et étaient en fait des copies d'expositions qui étaient, comme vous montre le graphique, sous forme de U-Matic, Betacam, VHS, BetaSP et du AI-8. Un inventaire fait en 2008 a révélé que seulement 0,05% des acquisitions, en fait, étaient des bandes maîtresses. Lors de l'acquisition de ces films, l'institution regardait ces copies d'exposition comme étant l'œuvre. Les supports d'information étaient alors préservés et entreposés, tout comme le reste de la collection. L'importance était attribuée à l'objet et beaucoup moins au contenu. Le second geste important qui fut posé par le Musée des beaux-arts du Canada fut en 1991, lorsqu'il crée un poste de commissaire à l'art médiatique qui fut occupé par Jean Gagnon, un critique d'art et commissaire, qui est maintenant devenu commissaire, jusqu'en 1998. Jean Gagnon avait un budget annuel dédié à l'acquisition des arts médiatiques d'environ 50 000 $ par année. Et puis, je vous présente ici une œuvre que Jean a en fait acquise pour le musée, qui est portrait numéro 1 de Luc Courchêne, qui est ici avec nous aujourd'hui. À ce moment-là, le département de la restauration et de la conservation des œuvres d'art était composé de restaurateurs de matériaux et techniques traditionnels. On avait des restaurateurs de sculptures, de peintures et de papier. Mais il y avait aussi un restaurateur à l'art contemporain, Richard Gagné, qui est maintenant directeur au Musée des beaux-arts de Montréal. Il n'y avait pas de protocole ni de politique pour la restauration de ces œuvres d'art-là. Alors, c'est donc Richard et Jean, avec la collaboration du service de l'audiovisuel, que les premiers efforts des succès de préservation se sont faits. Les vidéos étaient restaurées à l'interne parce que le service de l'audiovisuel avait en fait l'équipement pour le faire, mais les films étaient restaurés à l'externe. Plusieurs restaurations ont été réalisées, dont celle d'un film de Michael Snow, Rameau's Nephew by Diderot, Thanks to Dennis Young by Wilma Schoen, qui était conçu en 1974, ainsi que des vidéos de Noël Harding, comme que vous voyez à l'écran. C'est en 2005 que le département de la restauration joint activement le projet d'OCAM, qui avait été fondé par la Fondation Daniel Langlois. Deux œuvres de la collection font notamment partie des études de cas, dont celle de Max Dean et Raffaello D'Angelo, La Table, qui a été en fait documentée de fond en comble, et aussi l'œuvre de Jenny Holzer, You Next Sign numéro 2. L'œuvre de Jenny Holzer, en fait, ne fonctionnait plus et a été reconstruite par le studio. C'est aussi en 2005 que le musée implémente une interdiction temporaire d'acquérir les œuvres d'art médiatique. L'interdiction venait de la haute direction et du conseil administratif face aux risques institutionnels que ces œuvres imposaient. Il était finalement clair que ces œuvres ne pouvaient survivre sous les principes traditionnels de la restauration ni de la politique d'acquisition à l'époque. C'est avec le support de la Fondation Daniel Langlois que le musée engagea Mona Jimenez, archiviste médiatique au NYU, et Pip Lawrenson, chef de la collection et de la recherche à la Tate, afin d'étudier la collection du Musée des beaux-arts du Canada et d'émettre des recommandations face à la collection permanente et celle à venir. D'après les recommandations Lawrenson-Jimenez, une politique d'acquisition accrue fut alors implantée. Je vais vous épargner le document au complet, mais je vais vous énumérer les grandes lignes directrices qui, en fait, sont importantes dans cette présentation parce que ce sont les lignes, en fait, qui ont été réévaluées tout récemment. Alors, à l'acquisition, le musée devait acquérir une copie maîtresse, non compressée et ou des négatifs, s'il avait été analogue. Les formats Betacam SP, Digibeta et les disques durs étaient les préférés. Acquérir les droits de reproduction afin d'exposition, de prêt et de préservation. Et puis finalement, ne plus acquérir l'équipement original, mais plutôt du tout nouvel équipement selon les recommandations de l'artiste et dédier l'équipement à l'œuvre. Après l'acquisition, le musée créait des sous-copies maîtresses en plus de copies d'exposition, résultant un total de 3 copies pour chaque œuvre. En 2007, le département de la restauration engage Ainsley Walton à titre de boursière afin d'inventorier la collection d'art médiatique, d'évaluer leurs conditions et d'émettre un document citant les priorités selon l'urgence de chaque cas face à l'obsolescence. La première étape fut de faire une mise à jour sur la liste des œuvres d'art cinématographique qui étaient protégées par les droits d'auteur et les normes du CRTC. Ce sont donc des œuvres qui requéraient l'interaction d'un distributeur afin de diffusion. Une chose qui n'avait pas été prise en compte à l'époque lors de l'acquisition de ces films était le fait que l'acquisition de ces copies ne nous donnait pas de droits de duplication, ni pour la diffusion, ni pour la préservation. Alors, le musée s'est assuré que les distributeurs en question avaient en leur possession des copies de qualité supérieure aux nôtres, ce qui s'est confirmé. Et depuis, nous considérons que cette collection n'est plus à risque puisqu'elle est disponible et les copies physiques que l'on a en fait au musée ne sont plus préservées. Le reste de la collection, dont les formats analogues, furent migrés sur des formats Betacam SP, Digibeta et transférés sur des disques durs pour les formats HD par le département de l'audiovisuel. Et un autre fait accompli fut en fait la digitalisation de la collection des diapositives. Vous voyez ici, lorsqu'on n'avait pas les négatifs ou que les négatifs étaient inexistants, on a créé des négatifs RGB à partir d'une copie exposition couleur pour en fait en refaire la réimpression. Alors, je vous montre ici la croissance de la collection d'œuvres d'art médiatiques ou numériques au Musée des beaux-arts du Canada par an. Alors, c'est un total de 1619 œuvres qui requièrent une attention accrue et régulière. Vous voyez aussi qu'en 1997, Jean Gagnon est allé sur un shopping spree et a acheté 362 œuvres d'art. Et puis, voici un tableau, en fait, de la diversité des œuvres qui sont dans la collection. Beaucoup de vidéos et de films. Des œuvres diapositives, on en a 17. Audio 31, robotique 15, autres, en fait, incluent les œuvres qui ont un ou plus de ces types de médias, en fait, ensemble, parce qu'on ne voulait pas dupliquer les numéros. Alors, je suis allée trop vite. C'est pas grave. Plusieurs années ont passé depuis, et malheureusement, les efforts de migration ne sont pas terminés. Ce qui indique que les tactiques de préservation qui avaient été recommandées par Jimenez Lawrenson, en fait, sont inadéquates pour la réalité du Musée des beaux-arts du Canada. C'est donc en 2012 que l'on révise encore une fois entièrement notre politique d'acquisition et de préservation des œuvres d'art numériques. Les raisons de cette évaluation sont, comme je disais, une période de 10 ans s'est écoulée depuis les premières migrations et celles-ci doivent être réévaluées, les plateformes surtout. Le Digibeta n'est pas adéquat pour le HD et... Excusez. C'est ça, pour le HD. Le HD est entreposé sur des disques durs qui ne sont pas considérés comme des systèmes d'archives à long terme. Le taux de perte d'information d'un disque dur sur une étagère est de 3 à 8 %L'ampleur de la collection est telle que les ressources humaines et monétaires sont insuffisantes pour la migration régulière des œuvres, parce que la collection grandit, mais on n'a pas plus d'employés. Les problèmes d'entreposage ne permettent plus la duplication des formats et la dédicace de l'équipement. Et puis, un des problèmes qui était vraiment spécifique au Musée des Beaux-Arts, qui n'est peut-être pas représentatif de d'autres institutions, c'est que l'équipement était acheté avec les budgets d'acquisition. Donc, il prenait un statut d'œuvre d'art. Il devait être manipulé, encaissé comme une sculpture en bronze, en fait. Alors, et mis en entrepôt avec les autres œuvres d'art. Et puis, il y avait donc des problèmes d'accès. Alors, le musée est en processus d'acquisition d'un système d'archivage LTO. Le choix de ce système est basé sur les pratiques de plusieurs institutions phares qui collectionnent les œuvres d'art numériques, dont le Museum of Modern Art, le Guggenheim, Tate Modern, Walker Art Center et aussi VTAPE à Toronto. Le musée est en retard par rapport au changement de plateforme de préservation. Par contre, une chose qui nous a vraiment aidé à vendre notre salade au conseil, c'est que l'utilisation du LTO, en fait, a été depuis plusieurs années et puis a fait ses preuves. Et puis, les projections aussi de capacité de système à pouvoir supporter les formats plus volumineux et même les nouveaux formats à venir aident aussi à la justification de l'acquisition du système LTO. Alors, la prochaine vidéo, en fait, que je vais vous montrer, c'est juste pour faire du visuel pendant que je finis ma présentation. C'est une vidéo d'une entrevue, d'un travail qu'on a fait avec Michael Snow en 2009 sur l'œuvre de l'art. Alors, pour les processus d'acquisition, une des réalités aussi du Musée des Beaux-Arts du Canada, c'est que chaque œuvre doit avoir un rapport d'acquisition qui est signé par la haute gestion et le directeur du conseil. Alors, afin de responsabiliser la décision d'acquérir une œuvre d'art de type médiatique, le département de la restauration a décidé... Je vais juste fermer ça. OK, non, ça ne marche pas. OK. Qu'est-ce qui s'est passé? Ah. Je pense qu'il y a un problème avec les fils. OK, mais je vais continuer. Afin de responsabiliser la décision d'acquérir une œuvre d'art de type médiatique, le département de la restauration a décidé d'ajouter des prédictions face aux coûts associés à chaque œuvre d'art sur une période de 30 ans. De plus, deux clauses sous forme de questions se sont aussi ajoutées au rapport d'acquisition. Oui, je ne sais pas qu'est-ce qui se passe. OK. Juste pour... Oui. 5 minutes? Oui, j'ai moins de 5 minutes. OK. Bon, je ne toucherai plus. Alors, la première question qu'on répondait, en fait, c'était « Est-ce que cette œuvre est fonctionnelle, instable? A-t-elle un vice inhérent qui demande une attention soutenue à l'instant ou dans le futur? Le Musée des Beaux-Arts du Canada possède-t-il les ressources financières et expertise nécessaires à la préservation et la mise en exposition de cette œuvre? » Souvent, les réponses étaient non à ces questions-là. Une autre pratique qui fut arrêtée est celle de dédier l'équipement, sauf si celui répondait non à l'une ou plusieurs des questions suivantes. Première question était, est-ce que l'équipement joue un rôle dans l'esthétique de l'œuvre, soit par les modifications ou un traitement esthétique quelconque? Est-ce que la technologie existe encore, ou existe-t-il de l'équipement ou des programmes contemporains pouvant répliquer ou supporter le codec et les fonctions de l'équipement obsolète? Existe-t-il l'expertise pour restaurer l'équipement? Et la dernière question était, l'artiste nous donne-t-il les droits de transfert technologique? Parce que souvent... les artistes refusaient de nous donner le droit de faire l'immigration. Alors, le département d'audiovisuel émet donc maintenant des recommandations d'équipement qui sont approuvées par les artistes, mais qui sont partagées entre les œuvres. Les coûts sauvés d'entreposage sont alors mis de côté et réservés à l'achat d'équipement annuellement, basés selon les activités du musée et des prêts et de la popularité des œuvres d'art. C'est un peu triste, mais c'est la réalité du monde musical. La prochaine étape est de retirer tout équipement et œuvres d'art de leurs caissons et des réserves. Nous sommes en train de construire deux nouveaux entrepôts pour l'équipement dédié, mais aussi pour les œuvres elles-mêmes. Les entrepôts seront équipés de manière à pouvoir tester l'équipement et les œuvres d'art de façon régulière et à performer les réparations et migrations nécessaires. Alors, je ne suis pas toute seule à faire tout ce travail-là. Je suis responsable de la collection de l'art contemporain. Alors, l'art numérique n'est qu'un très petit pourcentage. J'ai 110 000 œuvres d'art à m'occuper. Alors, 1631 œuvres numériques, je ne peux pas donner tout mon temps à ça. Alors, voici l'équipe qui participe activement à faire que l'on puisse s'occuper de cette collection-là au Musée des Beaux-Arts du Canada. Merci.
Merci, Geneviève. Mark Heller is a technology consultant for cultural institutions in the San Francisco Bay Area and beyond. He's owner of Heller Studios, LLC. Mark specializes in creative yet practical digital media solutions for media artists and for the institutions that support their work, with an emphasis on developing systems and best practices for archiving, documentation, and exhibition. Mark has worked on media conservation initiatives at SF MoMA, MoMA, the Solomon Guggenheim Museum, and the conservation on the conservation and care of their software-based artworks. He's also developing software for the artist Lynn Hirschman Leeson and oversaw the installation of her retrospective Civic Radar at the ZKM in Karlsruhe. Mark Heller.
For having me today, it's a great honor and pleasure to be here. I love the Canadian Center for Architecture. I was here back in May. And so my talk's called Engaging Computer-Based Art, What is Found There? And in the talk, I want to share a selection of three works from the collection SF MoMA. And these works, they're great projects, and they span the collections of the Media Art, Architecture, and Design departments. And so the first work is Agent Ruby by Lynn Hirschman Leeson, which I've been working on for a long time. I started working on this in 2009. And the piece, so in 2001, 2002, SF MoMA commissioned Agent Ruby. It's up at agentruby.sfmoma.org from Lynn Hirschman Leeson, the acclaimed San Francisco artist. And they commissioned this for their pioneering online exhibition platform, eSpace. They were doing online exhibitions at the time. And so Ruby is an artificially intelligent web avatar that is shaped by and reflective of encounters and adventures it has with her users. You go and you chat with her. And Ruby was conceived as an e-dream portal, a new experience in expanded cinema, originating from the character Ruby, played by Tilda Swinton in Hirschman Leeson's 2002 feature film, Technolust. And so I was asked by the museum to help with the conservation and care efforts for Ruby, and we began the process of documentation. And in documenting Ruby, we found a really complex system, a lot of different programs working together. There were multiple servers, one that served up a public interface, and another that facilitated the dialogue between the user, and yet another server, which is the artificial intelligence interpreter. And so there's this public facing interface. It was created in Macromedia Flash at the time, now Adobe, and that's becoming challenging as some of us may know. And so that was the public interface. And then there was the brain or the personality, which consisted of 22,000 entries written in a language, a flavor XML called Artificial Intelligence Markup Language, or AIML, and this made up Ruby's brain. AIML, it was a dialect of XML, and it was developed by AI researcher Dr. Richard Wallace and a worldwide free software community. And AIML originally formed the basis for a bot called ALICE, Artificial Linguistic Internet Computer Entity, which won the annual Loebner Prize competition, Artificial Intelligence, 3 times. And it was a language that you could craft an artificially intelligent bot in, and this is what Ruby's personality was created in. In addition to a set of AIML, so that's like the personality, you needed a program to interpret it. And so in Ruby's case, it was a program called Program D, written by Noel Bush. And so this program took the set of AML, and then it facilitated a user's input and matching patterns against this set of artificial intelligence markup language to return the response. And so that's behind the interface, and that's kind of the machinery of the bot. So these are some important components. At the time there was, when we were doing this documentation in 2009, there was also the original hardware, this beige PC on the left, which had been running continuously on the internet for 8 or so years. And you can see it has a parallel port and a floppy drive and some PS2 ports and things like that. And so in 2009, after documenting the work, we cited the hardware as one of the biggest risks of failure, and it's something we should address, you know, right away. So our focus at that time of this conservation exercise was to migrate the software from the original hardware into a system known as a virtual server or virtual machine. So here's SFMOMA's server farm, and so many things run on there as virtual servers, email servers, point of sale systems, and in this case, an artwork. And so that's what our research at the time was. And during that process of migration, we found some interesting artifacts, some interesting stuff, such as an alternate interface, which more resembled the one shown in the film TechnoLust. And there was also a 3D model and a snippet of unused code that hinted at an animated 3D avatar. And this foreshadowed some of Lynn's later works, such as a piece called Dina, which uses a 3D animated avatar, and that's on display at the Whitney Museum in New York right now. And then there was this 8 gigabyte log file of all the conversations that Ruby ever had with the visitors, and I thought that was like the best thing ever. And while these components were super exciting, they were not considered essential to the work at the time and what we were trying to do, a migration to a virtual server. But Ruby became stabilized, and she was running, and actually presented on this work at DOCAM Summit in 2010. And so she's running. And then in 2013, Rudolf Freeling, curator of media arts at SFMOMA, says, you know, I want to display Ruby. And he was really interested in the log files, so he emails me. He's like, print out all the log files. And I was like, you know, Rudolf, that's like 8 truckloads of paper. And I said, I don't think we can do that in San Francisco, you know, the ecological, you know, conservation. I don't think they're going to like that show. So we wrote a bunch of Python scripts to mine conversations based on topics designated by the curator, such as science fiction, feminism. And then it was showed as the Agent Ruby files. You know, it had this tagline. And it's been shown like that ever since. So there's all these binders next to Ruby and this wall vinyl that has all these conversations. And so it's interesting because it's kind of shifted how it's shown. And that's how it's loaned out now. And it's since the show in SFMOMA, it's been exhibited at least 4 times this way, including Lynn's retrospective at the Museum Zetkayem in Karlsruhe in 2014. So also in 2009, we called out vulnerabilities in our report, and we were looking at Java and Flash. Program D was in Java. And Flash, you know, we knew Flash was going to be an issue then. It didn't run on the iPad, and Steve Jobs wrote a letter about it, so we called it out, and we're like, okay, we're going to wait and see. And so this year, Google announced they're not going to block Flash entirely. They're going to disable it for only sites which support Flash, but you'll get a little pop-up. So forgive my art in crisis slide. But the same happened with Java applets. You had to enable them, and then eventually they just didn't run anymore. So I flagged that, and I brought it up to my boss at SMOMA. And meanwhile, in 2014, Lynn, she had this awesome show. She's been doing really well in Europe, Civic Radar at ZKIM. And so she asked me, I work for her independently outside of the museum, she's like, let's develop a new bot. That's Peter Weibel, the director of ZKIM. And so with my colleague, we create a new bot, and this is an AIML-based bot. And but instead of Program D, it uses a new AIML interpreter called Program-O, and that's written in a language called PHP, which is fairly, you know, well-supported. Oh, hold on. And Program D was abandoned in 2006. So more modern language. And Program-O's got people still developing on it, quite actively, actually. There's Twitter features and all this stuff. And additionally, the animation for that bot was done in HTML5 Canvas. So there's no Flash involved. It's all native HTML5, PHP, fairly, you know, well-supported language. And so I went... we have a great team at SFMOMA called Team Media that has conservation, collections, curatorial, installation, and more. We talk about the media art. We meet. And so I went and I proposed a code migration to Ruby based on the work I was doing with Lynn on the other bots. And we have a lot of critical dialogue, and the question came up, why not emulation? And so we've had great conversations with Zachary, Dragon at Rhizome, about emulation. We use emulation in the museum. So we're going to plan to evaluate a migration and an emulation, and we'll put them side by side. And of course, we'll be working with the artists and team media. So this research is forthcoming early next year. Okay, so the next work I want to talk about, and I really love this project, was Susan Kerr and her Macintosh icons, a co-acquisition. Susan Kerr, she's a prolific, influential artist, graphic designer, created many of the interface elements and icons for the Apple Macintosh in the 1980s, such as the Happy Mac, the Bomb, and the Trash Can icon, which you may have encountered once or twice. She also designed the Solitaire interface for Microsoft Windows and many, many, many other very influential, many other designs. And so she made a gift of her sketchbooks to two museums, a joint gift to two museums, SFMOMA and MoMA last year. And so here's a few details of her sketchbooks. In addition, she's like, you know, I've got this box of 300 floppy disks, and I don't really know what's on them. And we were like, whoa, we got so excited about this. Really excited. This was like conservation dream, you know, digital media dream. But we also knew there's a lot of barriers to access here. Obsolete media, 3 1/4 floppy disks. I haven't had a floppy drive for a while. File systems might not be readable anymore. And we might not have the original software that created the files. It might be some weird image format or something like that. So these are things we tackled. And so the first order of business was to tackle the obsolete media, get the data off those disks. So there's a great piece of hardware called the CryoFlux, and it was developed by the Software Preservation Society that's largely based in Europe. And this is driven by the games community. Software Preservation Society used to be called the Classic Amiga Preservation Society, and they wanted to preserve all the games so they could run them in emulations. So there's a nice piece of hardware and a floppy drive, and they'll sell you this as an institutional license or a personal license if you want to. If you have an archive of floppy disk. And there's a great piece of software as well. This facilitates reading the disks, helps detect errors, and so it helps you make an exact image, virtual image, a bit-by-bit perfect image of a floppy disk. So we went through, we went through all 300 disks and batches of disk images, and a lot of them, you know, on OS X or modern operating system, I just click and and the files would open, and so this was great. But then we had a percentage, maybe about 20% I don't know the exact number, where we get no mountable file systems. And so we're like, oh, and there must be some corruption. And so that's what we thought. And we kept trying. So we're collaborating. And my good colleague, Benfino Radden at MoMA, he's like, well, I'll try and opening them in this emulator, Mini VMac. It's a Macintosh 128K emulator. And they opened fine. And it turned out these 20% of disks were in the Macintosh file system format. Which Apple dropped support for in OS 8, but they opened fine in emulators, so we were like, woo, we're back on track. But then we found that Susan Kerr, she worked on a lot of these files in a software called Electronic Arts Studio 8, and we didn't have that software, and so we were scanning the internet, and we're like, oh, we gotta find it, and all we could find was this obscure article from a computer magazine, you know, in the early 90s that referenced this software, and we're like, ah, and so it was like, you know, we kind of like felt sad at that point. But then we found a copy of the software, an installer of it on one of the disk images. We're like, awesome, but it just crashed horribly, and then we're like, oh, and so like it was quite depressing again. And so we kept trying all these things, and eventually we just opened them in Photoshop 1, and they opened. And so we found some of these beautiful treasures, and so that was kind of luck, a cautionary tale. And also during this time, we started discovering many of these icons were in color. We're looking at a lot of files in black and white, and then we fired up a color emulator, and we have this world of color, and so it was quite amazing. So here's some stamps and things like that. So we got past these barriers, and so we tackled these barriers, but the question now is how to give easy access to the curators in a standardized way across institutions. So we built a Linux-based server that ran an emulator in a web browser. And so we worked together, and so we worked with each institution to deploy this server we created on the local area network behind the firewall to each institution. And then the curators simply had to go to a URL, log in, and then they could load the files in Photoshop 1 in this emulator. We made it easy access. You can't really tell all curators, like, fire up the Linux virtual machine and then, you know, type this at the terminal. So this is what we did to sort of create easy access. Yeah, we did write a manual on the basics of Photoshop 1, because I think that's difficult for many. And we also created a standard numbering system for the disk images, indexed them in a spreadsheet so that the curators could take notes and compare these across institutions and have interesting dialogue. And in addition to Team Media, we also have Team A&D, Architecture and Design, said we like the collaborations you're doing in the Media Arts Department. We want to form a Team A&D. So we had these study days, and this study day was for an exhibition focusing on Bay Area high-tech design. And we asking questions like, well, how do you show a Palm Pilot? Or should we get an exhibition copy of a Macintosh 128K? And questions like, how do you show Google Glass? And then I made a Raspberry Pi with the Mini VMac emulator. I was like, maybe we should show the icons like that. So we have a lot of discussions, group discussions, critical discussions about modalities of display and things like that. Yes. Okay, 5 minutes. Okay, I'm just going to shoot through this last one really quick. Greg Lynn, I know CCA has done some great collaborations with Greg Lynn. He's an innovator in redefining the media of design with digital technology, as well as a pioneer in the fabrication of complex functional ergonomic forms using CNC machinery. And for Biennial Interior, 2012, he created a prototype for a motorized compact living cocoon that rotates to provide space for relaxing, sleeping, and bathing. So this is Room Vehicle Prototype 2012, and here's an image of it, and it's a thing. And so this increases living space that, you know, as it rotates, 150 meters of living surface is realized within a 60-meter footprint. And so it's a very interesting model. And so that was the 1/5 scale model. There's also a 1/20 scale model. And SFMOA acquired the 20th scale model in 2015. And so a loan request was made, and so it recently got deinstalled. So we took the period to do great documentation, beautiful construction, carbon fiber shell that had been cast in a CNC mold. The interior is 3D printed and gimbaled, so it always balanced the rotation of the house. And it sat on top of this shell with two NEMA 23 stepper motors that controlled the pan and tilt. And God, I just love this. I went out and bought a 3D printer like as soon as I saw it. Now I know too. But stepper motors are very precise, and they have a series of coils. And with computer-controlled stepping, you achieve very precise positioning and speed control. These are the little computers, the stepper controllers. They're one for each motor, and each one's a tiny CPU network connectivity and memory store. They all have their own little language, and so this was one of the demo sequences created by Lin Studio to tilt. And additionally, he created a tablet app in a program called TouchOSC, and so it allowed you to, manually control the house. And I asked the technician from Lin Studios, like, would you be in the house with the tablet and wake up? And he's like, yeah. And so this was cool. So he created this thing, and that was used OSC, used open sound controls, developed to the Center for New Music Technology, and and so it was great to see that technology here, that data protocol, and it reminded me that data protocols are as important as code and components, and that's how all these networks come together. And with that, I want to say thank you. Thank you to the organizer of the conference, Canadian Center for Architecture, RLE, all of you, and thank you for having me.
Now invite everyone to come up to the stage, and we can follow up these very stimulating presentations with a little bit of discussion. So we'll begin by a discussion between the three presenters on stage, and then we'll open it up to questions from the floor. I've been tasked with passing a microphone around, so I'll be down on in the audience once we've perhaps done some initial reactions to one another's presentations. I don't know if anybody has anything to pitch in just right off the bat. I noted a few things from each of your presentations that I thought were particularly that particularly grabbed my attention anyway. Aria, you're basing your strategies on the recognition that digital culture is focused on practice as opposed to artifact was I thought really interesting. Oh, that's the end of your time, Mark. And also the emphasis on mass culture as opposed to institutionalization of particular works. Genevieve, I'm really interested to hear about how new approaches that are always more appropriate to the realities of digital artworks are gradually and steadily being adopted at the National Gallery. And I think it's really interesting that you recognize and act on the need to constantly reevaluate those strategies, to keep returning to earlier decisions and making sure that they are still pertinent to changing technological realities. And Mark, I was really captivated by the hands-on approach that you seem to take to all of your preservation projects. And it strikes me that the work that you do is in very direct and immediate conversation with the artists, and you're really engaging with the technological material in a way that speaks directly to the artist's own practice. And I wonder if any of you would have anything to say about those sort of key points that I found out or anything else that you'd like to add.
Well, So I had a meeting with Zachary, who's the director of Rhizome. I mean, you guys are doing excellent, excellent work, outstanding work. Dragon, Espen Chide, your director of preservation, great person. And so there's great efforts in emulation. And I met with Zachary, and I said, Zachary, do we emulate or do we migrate? Yes. And so there's so many different cases and strategies.
Well, yeah, it's very interesting. I mean, I started working for Rhizome only 2 months ago right now, yes. So it's been a wild ride, and like we jumped into this NetArt anthology project, and I think it's really interesting. I think Dragon is amazing at what he does, and can speak for hours on it in such compelling ways. I think it becomes very interesting because even already we've only done about 6 projects in the anthology, and like in terms of like each practice is so different, and in terms of like emulating or trying to migrate or like just documenting, there's always like I think we're already finding that this idea of like a hard and fast like emulation approach doesn't necessarily even work because there's already like, you know, things that can't be, you know, approached that way. But yeah, I don't know, it's really interesting.
But there's also many things that's the only way you can approach, and we had some works by John Maeda, the reactive books, and these are pieces. It was in the era of the CD-ROM, a multimedia CD-ROM, and he wanted to push that. So he wrote these software pieces in C++ for Macintosh OS 9, and they were exploring the interactivity of the computer, the trackpad, and the little ball quick cam at the time, and things like that. And so the curators wanted to show him, and they're like, well, you know, my idea is like, I don't have the source code. And, you know, that was dealing with interactivity with the IMAX at the time, and so I've moved on. And so that was perfect. And so we did approach that in emulation.
Yeah, and I think it also, it works well for at least like a lot of the artists we've worked with so far who, didn't necessarily do the work to preserve like the code or whatever, because that wasn't what they were interested in necessarily, or because they didn't have the capabilities. And so I think that this solution does work well with dealing with that as well, when like, they don't have like an archive sitting around that like, you know, like, oh yeah, here, just like, you know, do this. And then it becomes very, I don't know, I'm really interested. We had a meeting with Ben Fino-Raden at MoMA also, and we're talking about working on presenting the thing and like, how do you do that? And which is like, would be an extremely intense, like, you know, expansive project. And I think, again, returning to this idea of like practice, it's like, for me as like as a curator, I'm really fascinated by the idea of like, where does the practice end? And you know, do we have to recreate the entire message board and everything that happened there in order to do that? So, yeah.
Would you say that there's already knowledge existing or perhaps currently developing around in which kinds of cases an emulation approach should be favored over a migration approach? I mean, is there a cheat sheet for like what are the cases in which we would favor migration? Oui, Geneviève.
I think they are, especially with the. When the artwork is actually a sculpture, it actually has an aesthetic component to it. And also, I think it's important in some ways that to keep the historical context, especially when an artwork is on exhibition. Like at the gallery, we try to show films from the 1960s under original format, because on a flat screen TV doesn't make any sense. And the visitor is actually like doesn't understand what's happening. They just think it's a shitty video on a very nice TV. So in that context, I think, that's sometimes emulation is like the right thing to do over migration, but it's not always possible.
And what are the limiting cases? Like what are some of the impediments that you find continuing to show work in the exact format in which the artist had devised it.
Can you repeat it?
Well, you say that there are limits, that sometimes it's not possible to show the work exactly in the way that the artist had intended. So, yeah. What are some of those? What are some of those cases? And can you talk about maybe how compromises can be found?
Well, compromises, like there's always, well, it's like emulation, it's like basically faking old technology, like encasing new technology in old ones. It's like a lot of tape cassette players can hide MP3 players in them, and then you just have them running.
I think there's this debate. Is it the same work? I was working with the museum, and they had some Java applets, and they wanted me to do some research on how to emulate them in the web browser. So I built this Linux server and put it on Amazon, and it launches up a headless web browser that supports Java applets, and then it just renders that in the user's canvas. And I was like, that's a lot of work to, you know, preserve the applet. You know, the artist is still alive, just have them port it to JavaScript. And then so we had this debate, like, that's not the same piece. And I was like, is it the same piece? when we build this entire like base underneath it and then show it in a in this particular web browser through this layer. You know, again, I'm open to both, but there's some debate here. And then, at what point is it? Where, you know, it needs to get shown. Because the thing with NetArt is like you might have looked on Netscape Navigator, you might have looked at it in Opera and Chrome, you know, all these different browsers, and they might have rendered slightly different. So.
Yeah. I think another something else that I've been coming across in working with artists is the varied. Approach to the hardware also, or like how important that is to different artists. Like some people, like for instance, we recreated My Boyfriend Came Back from the War without like, you know, the same kind of desktop computer that it would have been shown on in like 96. But then some people who saw the work were like, well, why isn't it on that computer? And then we were like, well, we don't, like we're a digital institution, we don't have an exhibition space. And then we did the file room, Anthony Muntadas was like, oh, I wish we'd had a file, like an installation, because initially it was like this like whole room that you would enter. And so that's something that's really, like for us is hard because we're a pretty small organization and we don't have access to a physical space all the time. But sometimes these works, in some people's eyes, require that aspect. But then, like and again, like what, is that the work or is it the, you know, practice that developed? I don't know, it's everything is confusing, I guess.
Yeah, and to add to that, I think there's a lot of artists, like they have like a very aesthetic mind when sometimes like as like curators or conservators, like we think more technically, how can we reproduce that? We had some instances at the gallery where like we were upgrading the projectors for some video projections, and we found out later on that the artists like weren't happy about that because there were subtleties that older projectors, like a quality of the image that it was giving, that he liked, and that's why he chose that kind of projector. So sometimes migrating and upgrading technology is not a aesthetical solution that is approved by the artists either.
Sure. Yeah.
One thing I thought was really interesting about the approach that you take, and I've heard about it from Lichelle Gagné as well, is you talked about the artist questionnaire, like a certain number of questions that are asked of the artist prior to acquisition. And I think that seems to me like a key practice that to a sustainable approach to long-term conservation of works, because as Aria was just saying, you know, the approaches that different artists may have to technology is always very different. And unless you've explicitly made clear what the artist's attitudes are towards, you know, a particular piece of hardware, a particular projector, a particular presentation interface, all of these things become, I think, really crucial to the downstream long-term conservation of the work?
I would say short-term conservation of the work. We do artist interviews and ask them, like in 500 years, where do you see your artwork? and, you know, like give them the worst case scenarios of what can be done, what cannot be done. But we always have to keep in mind that these artworks are under copyright laws. So whenever we're doing a major intervention on those artworks, we need to work with the artists, and artists change their minds. And I don't want to generalize, but there's a lot of artists that, you know, it's like they're not as active as they used to be, so often they want to upgrade their artwork technologically so they can be amongst the new young hot artists. And so there is always, yeah, it's like we can't use those artist interviews and documentation as like fixed information that's going to basically direct the restoration and conservation of those artworks.
Well, we had an interesting work at SFMOMA. It's a piece called Victor by Jörg Lenny, and it's this great robot, and it has these motorized wheels, and it basically draws vector graphics on the wall, and it runs on a little ARM-based board, not unlike a Raspberry Pi, but there's a lot of complex software with it. And so one interesting aspect that the conservator worked out with Jörg is they have a shared source code repository. He's a Swiss artist. He's very Swiss, and so he's always wants to upgrade and tweak the software. And in this software, in the source code repository, you have snapshots of the code every time it changes, and you can revert back and things like that. And so we presented that at the Guggenheim last year, and some thought that was controversial because the art should remain as it was upon acquisition. And in many ways, it does in this source code repository, but it does need maintenance and, you know, tweaking as well. So Martina, the conservator, allows for Jörg to actively contribute new source code patches to this work.
I'd like to open it up to questions from the floor. Is anyone reacting to? Okay.
Thank you. So, well, this is a question for all of you, but related to the NetArt ontology. I was reading the presentation text about the idea to sketch a possible canon of NetArt. So in all these preservation efforts, which I see this is a bit in the context in which we now have the pre-net art from some years, Ars Electronica launched this Digital Pioneers Award. So this effort to like write the history, tell which are the main artworks, etc. So there is all this part about setting up, telling to the future which would be the artworks that are worth preserving. And I wonder how you deal with this, how you deal with the decision of saying which artworks are worth all this tremendous effort of preservation and which would be forgotten, will disappear.
Well, I think for us, in launching the project initially, it was a big question, like did we want to say that part of the effort was to, you know, craft a canon in some sense, and I think we realized that, you know, if you're presenting 100 works of net art, like, and there's visibility for it, that's kind of something that just embedded in the project, and so we decided that we would admit to that and take it on. But I think that our goal is to, well, part of the project is to leave the submission, like open submission. So we have an email address on the website where we're asking people to, you know, give feedback, and it's also part of why it's not 2 years of research leading up to one exhibition where all the works are presented together. It's like a rolling basis where, you know, what gets presented, you know, now will inform what happens, you know, 6 months from now. It's kind of shifting and flowing. But yeah, I don't know. I mean, I think that it is hard. I mean, people are already like, well, is this going to be included? Like, this should be included, and I think it's very fraught territory. But our goal is to, while we're doing that, I think releasing the Old Web Today tool to the public and having that be something that's in the conversation. We're holding in February, we're holding a conference on digital social memory, and sort of like alongside this like idea of the canon, create like releasing tools and making people aware of tools to archive their like online artwork or just general online experience, and continuing to hold the digital as like a mass medium in our minds and to make that part of the conversation alongside of it. Because we, yeah, I don't think we want to present it as like, this is the canon, this is the hard and fast, like top 100 net artworks to know, like that kind of thing. But yeah.
Any other reactions to that question?
I'm supposed to restore everything equally. Because the collection of the gallery is basically, it's a People's of Canada collection. You pay for it with your taxes. But like I said in the presentation, we do risk assessment based on technology obsolescence to determine priorities. And another thing that we also consider very importantly is if the artists are still here or going to be here with us for a long time or not, when we decide to undertake our restoration projects.
Can I add, sorry, also for Rhizome, I think another thing is that we're interested in paying particular attention to practices that are in danger of being lost because of various factors, as well as highlighting artists who at the time maybe didn't get much attention for what they were doing, or also a lot of projects that at the time didn't seem particularly interesting, but now because of the way things have progressed have come back in terms of their relevance. So.
Yeah, I think both approaches are amazing. I've been showing a lot of colleagues lately the processing.org of the Processing Language Exhibition and how you can't run any of this history of creative coding exhibition from 1999 till whenever Apple isn't there anymore, and a lot of these artists, you know, they've moved on and not accessible, and these works are not in the collections of institutions, but they have a great importance in this history, works by Casey Riaz, Josh Ahn, all these works, and so I think in Rhizome's approach, it's very important, very beneficial, to this field. But I also understand the institution. Sometimes I'm known as the Agent Ruby guy, and I'll probably be working on Agent Ruby for the rest of my life. But the point with Ruby is it's an institution, and so it's constant research, and we see the life cycle is working. We pay really close attention. And I work for Lynn, and she's still alive. And so I can see, you know, I can interview her and talk to her and work in her studio, and so it's a very privileged place, and I really enjoy it. So both, I think, I'm an advocate for.
Some more questions? We'll go in the back first, and then here.
Hi, thanks for your presentations. They're very interesting. I'm interested in this question of sort of authenticity of emulations and migrated artwork. I'm the digital archivist here at the CCA, and it's something that we think about a lot with obsolete CAD software that also won't run contemporary environments. But you can look at it a lot of ways. Like, even if you have a fully authentic emulated experience, the experience of looking at that on a CRT monitor, like you were saying earlier, versus on a Retina screen on a modern MacBook Pro is always going to be pretty different. So I'm wondering what efforts you're taking to communicate these differences to the public, or to, especially in the case of a migration, maybe make transparent the work that you're doing and what effects it might have on the artwork itself.
Okay, I can start. When works of art on our exhibition, the first thing that you'll notice is that there's a didactic like carton on the wall that says when the work was recreated and when it was rebuilt. And we also put a description of the original technology and the new technology. It's very important for us to do that because If I don't know, if we change a light bulb, we won't do that, like from incandescent to LED. But if there's like a major migration, if the work has changed completely, then we do make it aware to people.
Go for it.
Hello. Hi. I have two questions, which is always a terrible start to question, but you can pick which one you want to answer. The first is, have you ever encountered an artist who, you know, I think back to the Fluxus artists in the 1960s and then the video artists that proceeded to follow them, where there was an intent for the work to disintegrate. It was, they were ephemeral works, and they sort of, that death of the artwork was a part of the intent of creating the work. Have you encountered artists that simply don't want their work preserved, that would like to see it have a graceful death and perhaps a funeral? And then two, are you starting to encounter, I'm an artist who works on the internet, and a lot of works recently start to integrate public APIs or work with outside servers and services. And I'm wondering if you've started to encounter that friction of working with IBM or Google to preserve artworks, and what their responsibility might be in future archiving and restoration.
So to the first question, so we worked with, we're working with John Maeda's Reactive Books. John Maeda is a, you know, really luminary in digital media. And he made these pieces, you know, in the late 90s. And each one, like one, it was about interacting with a trackpad, which was really innovative at the time. Trackpads were like brand new on those Lime iMacs. And the webcam and the Quipcam. And so he had a video one. And so he made these four books about interactivity with a computer, and actually NYU and Glenn Wharton at NYU, the students interviewed John Maeda, because the Reactive Books are also in the collection at the moment, and he's like, well, you know, these were about innovative interactions at the time. Now everybody, like, it's not innovative anymore. And the interview's online, and he wasn't really interested in their preservation so much. He's like, just make a video. And so that was interesting. Like, people, the interpretation people are gonna have has totally changed, so, and he's moved on because of that. So that was one encounter.
I haven't yet encountered an artist who doesn't want to recreate their work. But in terms of the dealing with like Google and stuff like that, I haven't dealt with that yet, but there is a piece that I think we will have to deal with it with, or something similar. That Anne Hirsch made an app that was censored a few years ago, and I think I'm really interested in trying to figure out how to make that work again, if it would mean like trying to create a censored version or dealing with like the iTunes or Apple Store and being like, I don't know, so that I think that could become interesting, because in talking to her, she was like, I don't want to do it if it's not interactive, like that doesn't, you know, it's not the work, so it'd be interesting.
No, I never encountered an artist that wanted to let his artwork die, especially in Taiwanese media. Like, it's interesting, though, that ephemeral practices, I never encountered them in that type of art.
I'm surprised to hear that, given that many artists go into work with unstable media, you know, fully cognizant of the fact that these things are not designed to last for decades or centuries.
Yeah, it isn't their problem after it's not theirs anymore. A lot of artists are like, you deal with it. Like, they don't want any ownership of it after that.
But I think we're seeing new interesting responses from artists, namely Rafael Lozano Hemmer and Casey Riaz, who are published manifestos on the conservation of software-based art and the artist's responsibility. And I was talking to Casey Riaz at opening San Francisco, and he's like, yeah, I'm porting some of my works. So
I think also, like, in like more recent practices also there, like the like sort of social media-based things are like the jogging on Tumblr or like, you know, Twitter-based practices where I think at the time, a lot of people are like really interested in how the work functions as a mass medium that can just get lost in the feed or whatever. But, you know, given like I think I've heard many of like the jogging members really, you know, wish that they could, have more of an archive of that than just like the way it is. Or, you know, with like Twitter poetry. How do you archive that when it's just amidst like, I ate, you know, oatmeal for breakfast, like, you know, and what are the objects that are, you know, worth preserving or not? So the problem only gets harder, I think, with social media as well.
More questions? I don't see any hands. I'd ask a question about it's sort of more of a structural question, I guess. One thing about the techniques that are brought to bear to preserve works is that they tend to be very custom, very particularized to the nature of a specific work. And I think an initiative like Old Web Today is really interesting because it solves a set of problems as opposed to a single one. And so I'm basically wondering about how this kind of work of conserving and preserving digital art, how it can be scalable, how can a solution be applied more generally, especially in a context where there's, you know, very limited funding available. The National Gallery is a major institution that has that is able to do work on a custom artist to artist basis because there's, you know, a few hundred works in the collection. But what happens when that number grows to the thousands or the tens of thousands? How do the strategies need to evolve in order to be sustainable at those kinds of scales?
At the gallery, what we're doing right now is basically we're not doing full migrations, but what we're doing is basically technology transfers that will enable us to do full migrations. So when works of art are not planned for any activities, so we do the minimum work that is necessary to make sure that these works evolve in time and also can be restored in the future. Yeah, because it's like you said, it's every work of art is very complex, and like material has been used or hacked by artists, so it's a case-to-case thing. And sometimes these projects can take up months and years to achieve, and then once you're done, then you kind of have to redo it again because technology has already changed. So what we do is just we try to basically bring that artwork onto a stable platform and without doing full migrations.
But I guess what I'm wondering is, because the amount of money invested, let's say, per project restored, it doesn't seem like it reduces with scale, right? You don't have, once you've solved a problem, you haven't necessarily solved, you know, the problems of dozens of other artworks. You do have to start over and over and over again. And given that there is so little funding that's available, at least in Canada, for the preservation of media art, how do we? What other possible solutions exist to arrive at a more stable ecosystem?
Well, I think, at Rhizome, something that we are doing, another project we have is this web recorder project, which is like a online archiving tool. So that's sort of, I guess, in a way, this preemptive strategy, I suppose. So giving people the tools to archive their online activity and create a living archive of that, which can be used by artists to try to, I don't know, but I don't know that I don't think it solves it, but I think it's like some element of this world of like the problem. And I think like just sort of expanding the conversation, I think what we're trying to do is expand the conversation around, broadly speaking, digital social memory, such that the artists that we are involved with also start to think like, oh, maybe it's worth it for me to go back and look at that project and try to figure out like what are the ways I can archive it, and so that everyone's kind of on the same page, so that doesn't happen when it's in danger of being lost. But like, for instance, like the platform Vine was just shut down, and there were so many like short little videos that, you know, are kind of little art objects unto themselves, and like these like ongoing practices by these people who really mastered the form, but now like Vine says that the archive will stay up, but you know, who knows what will happen. So we're really trying to be in dialogue with people about, okay, like you can use this tool to archive your online practice such that like you, and you hold it. It's not like, you know, we as an institution hold on to it necessarily. Like this is like your like activity, which also presents like an ethical problem about like, you know, yeah, like leaving a trace online or whatever. But yeah, that's something that we're trying to do and is like a drop in the bucket, I think, in terms of solving that.
A lot of those artworks are interactive, and some research centers now are filming navigations. Not only they don't want to only preserve the art piece, but they want also to preserve the interaction. So, how people are interacting, and that at the beginning of the project, and later. Years after, how people can interact too. So where is the documentation or the preservation of interaction, where you can put that thing in your strategies to conserve the art?
I'm going to say something that's going to sound very funny, but there was an effort for like documenting interaction and the experience of the user, and we do it whenever we can, but we also save all our security videos at the gallery and at them in the conservation files.
Creative use of resources.
I don't know if it's legal.
So, the role of documentation in preserving interactive works. Any other thoughts on that?
A few things that I was watching the video game exhibition at MoMA. And they were showing Tetris, and there was a small child and it didn't know what to make of it or how to interact with it. And I don't know how to do that. And then a funny anecdote: the room vehicle house, they put on the Facebook campus for a while, and the technician from Greg Lynn Studios was like, "Yeah," and they would just try and jump in it. So that's like an interaction you wouldn't want. But no, I haven't thought about like what is the proper way? Is it driven by the viewer? Or is it prescribed? I guess it could be either depending on the artwork, but no, I haven't thought about that, but I will think about that going forward.
Yeah, I think that when I start thinking about that question, I get into this very slippery slope of like considering the art object historically in its entirety and like, you know, like, yeah, like, well then like, where did, like, what about the interaction between, you know, yeah, like the viewer and an architectural space or the viewer and like a sculpture, and then it becomes really stressful. But I don't know. I mean, I think, yeah, it's something that I think practically speaking hasn't been of the greatest concern thus far, but I think is an important question.
Hi, thank you very much for your presentations. They've been fantastic. One of the things that people keep coming back to here is this idea of an official narrative, an official record of this part of the story of art. And I think it's quite clear, or at least to me it seems apparent, that due to the very rapid pace of change in formats in, from floppy disks and from previous kind of styles of digital media to what's happening now, that we've already lost an enormous chunk. I've no idea what the percentage would be, but there is a great deal of that that's not being captured, not being archived, and not being recorded. Do you feel that there is a need for a centralized museum, institution, database of some kind, as I do? And if so, and the much thornier question is, who should run it? Where should it be? And with what tools? But at the moment, I would if you agree, I would suggest that we are capturing and preserving and curating a very tiny percentage of the story of digital art.
Let's start a museum.
Who should run the World Digital Art Museum?
I think there should be, and then the question, and then my question too is who's going to do it. I think that we've talked about having central repositories of museums, but you know, the cultures are all very different, all different administrative, and then there's funding. But I think it'd be a good idea, not a central knowledge base, and so I advocate that as well.
Yeah, I think it would be great. I think it would be very difficult, and I don't know who could undertake it. And this, and likewise, especially with digital art, figuring out what goes in it, like what counts as art or art enough to be in the central database is vexing. But yeah, would be cool.
It leads to a question also of how works are activated. Like because any kind of platform interacts with its audience, and the audience of the National Gallery of Canada is not the same as the audience of Rhizome. And I think that the point of keeping work alive is to continue to animate and grow those audiences. But I think those audiences are also, in many ways, particular and specific. So there's, I think, a community dimension to any large-scale endeavor to preserve work because of the communities from which these works arise and also the communities to which they're directed.
Yeah, I think at Rhizome especially, that's always in our minds, like, there's such a rich community that's been, like, it's been such a hub for, like, the last 20 years, and there are people who are, like, super invested in what happens at Rhizome, and I think in my eyes, like, the NetArt Anthology project is this sort of, like, not like yearbook, but it is this, like, community resource in a way, and sort of giving people, like, a shout-out, like, you know, for the things, that, and it's interesting.
Anything else? Some other comments or questions or perspectives? Oui, Aurélie.
So basically all of you worked with the artist when you had to preserve the artworks or to re-engineer it, etc. I was wondering if you actually already went in the situation that the artist was not alive anymore, and what like difficulties that was to really know how to make the artwork again, or etc. When you mentioned that, for example, at the museum, at the gallery, you have interviews that you make with artists, but do you already like know that there are some aspects that are really difficult to keep, you know, in the archive to present again the artworks. If you have examples, for example,
example of when artists are no longer alive and then restoration projects had to be done. It's a lot more work. What we usually do is try to find other institutions that have artworks from the same era, from the same artists, and that the artists collaborated for the restoration of it. So that's the first step that we undertake. Like I said earlier, there's copyright laws, and so we have to basically talk to the estate of the artists and ask them for permission to do changes, migrations, or emulation. This can get a little bit complicated because there's a lot of estates that are not interested or that actually are hard to work with, not really understanding, let's say, you know, it's like that if they don't understand the technology,
then it's going to be very difficult to have rights from them to do those kinds of restoration work. Yeah,
we haven't worked with anyone who's passed away yet for this project.
I guess maybe just in conclusion, unless there's any other questions, I'm sort of interested in knowing how different actors in digital art preservation are managing to work together. I feel like there's a lot of good work that happens in a disparate and decentralized way. There was an interesting question just now about, you know, the need to centralize this work, perhaps in the form of a database or something along those lines. We no longer have a national preservation strategy as such. This is something that has been attempted several times and keeps falling by the wayside. There was a lot of very interesting work, which was, I guess you could say, centralized at DOCAM for a few years. What are the legacies of those sorts of initiatives, and how do what networks do people use to exchange practices and knowledge and to continue to work together?
So there's an alliance between MoMA, SF MoMA, and the Tate. It's called Matters of Media Art, and we just pushed out a new a site, mattersofmedia.org, and this is all about, in this case, storage and management for video art and large digital assets. We talk about storage strategies, geographically distributed backup strategies, managing your collection, dams, and all these other Archivematica and trusted repositories. So we've been doing that, and we decided to publish it on GitHub and be open source and things like that. And the DOCAM model was great. I remember being at the DOCAM Summit in 2010. Smithsonian has their time-based media working group, and so that's a collection of resources and things. But what I do see is, there's funding and there's initiative, and then you get this great, site, this great repository, and then it kind of loses funding and goes away. So how do we get beyond that? And I thought maybe that's just a question of the human condition and funding. But
there's different resources, like INCA actually published artist interviews regarding like preservation and restoration of their artworks. There's a few conservation associations that have time-based media under groups that also publish quite a bit of information that is available to anybody that is interested.
Okay. Well, thank you very much to our presenters, and thanks very much to everyone who came out and participated. This will be the end then of the morning sessions, and we resume after lunch at 2 o'clock here. Thanks, everyone. Thanks very much.